has some questions, I believe, as well, some written questions which we've replied to, and is entitled to submit a supplementary question for each of those. So we'll have a 3-minute statement from yourself, followed by questions if you have any.
Morning, everyone. Well, I'd like to say I still find it very hard to believe how you can say that it's benefiting our state where everybody's guaranteed to have their homes and affordable rents. You put in that, don't worry about it because of any kind of benefits off the government, but that the definition of itself means it's not affordable. Now, each of these residents can afford their current home. None of them, and I'm completely zero for everybody to see, no one can afford the new rents. These I classify as the new poor houses, which their residents are now being put into. I'd also want to basic the statements which we had, let's see, public question page 5 to 8, where I asked about problems with the intactable with the ground problem, constant maintenance problems with new rules on West End State. And you put, there is no ground problem of maintenance issues we are aware of. There are only there minor issues with cleaning and ventilation provision systems from the Wisconsin Housing Trust. These systems are never been cleaned since they've been in. There was no contract made up for them. They create a health hazard, which quite a few residents now are suffering from. Anyone who has a disability or infirmity cannot do these vents, and yet nobody has bothered them. And as far as the ground maintenance complaints, I could give you over 200 from the new build, not from the old build. I could give you about 20 from those. But that's the problems we've got, and that isn't the ones which I haven't talked to yet. The amount of problems which we're getting, and these have been there since they first moved in, and are still sitting there, like wheelchair adaption. The man in a wheelchair cannot do the adaption. She's been in the flat for nearly 2 years and still waiting for the adaption so she can use his kitchen properly, use his he'll be able to look out the front door because he can't use that. He can't use the bathroom properly. There was nothing there. He cannot open the windows. He cannot open the doors by himself because they're too heavy or they're too high for him to reach. We're still waiting for that to be done, even though that's been registered 3 times. Now, also, I'd like to put in the public inquiry, I mean, anybody that bothered to actually attend, was the fact that when you put down that the properties needed to be done, the answer was, I requested the answer about tackling ground coastal maintenance on the front of the West End estate. You basically put down that the estate is falling down and is unworkable. But in actual fact,
I think we've moved on to the questions anyway, haven't we? So we'll carry on if you've got questions. I think we're in that. Do carry on.
Right. Well, in actual fact, the council admitted in a public inquiry, second public inquiry, that it wasn't the reason they pulled the West End of the state down at all. The reason they wanted it down was to put more buildings in the same place. Now you're pulling down over 680 dwellings, 550 of which was agreed. Social dwellings, which was agreed, and we are now replacing about 2,000 new properties, of which only 219 are social dwellings. And you should, and you're going on about you haven't got the properties for these residents to stay in. The properties are there, you're just not replacing the ones you're putting down. We'd like you to replace those properties as was originally agreed in the pledge, which was signed by the council. With Metropolitan Housing, with the residents, please.
Thank you for that. The scheme has been agreed. You're requesting us to change the scheme, in essence, and we're not going to do that. So we'll carry on with the scheme and the phases, and the 10 years, the mixed 10 years, that we've already agreed. And this has been debated over many, many years. And now the plan is in place. So we appreciate that not all councillors or residents will agree on the final talk about the hearing as well. Again, that matter is now closed as far as the council is concerned. On the issues, though, of maintenance, cleaning vents, and I'm sorry to hear about the gentleman with the adaptations, still waiting for adaptations for his home. We have Councillor Craig here, one of your new councillors, passing those details of the resident concerns, and this within this report today, this all different bodies as well, these sort of things can be channeled through. And we will hasten those adaptations. It's not right that somebody can live in there for a long time, not able to open windows and access the property. So very happy to those issues we will take forward. On the plan for the scheme, it does continue. And indeed, we made a pledge during the election that we would continue with West Ham in the scheme as it was, and we will now honour that pledge. So we have questions for you now, Ms. Parsons. We'll take the housing, the opposition, the first Councillor Houston.
Thank you, Jasmin. In terms of speaking on the regeneration strategy, which lovely, I expect that you're speaking about, given your experience in West End, and what would you say are the key things that need to be included in that strategy in terms of existing tenants and leaseholders? Because that is something which I think you and particularly have real knowledge of the work anywhere.
Well, first of all, there's no need to move away from the original pledge, which was agreed. The new pledges, which was agreed behind closed doors, was not agreed with the residents, even though they had agreed with the agreement which was agreed in the first place. Now, the residents who are there, many of them will be living up there for almost 20 years, but they've still got no housing rights according to the non-secure title which they've been given, even though they're in council property, which is perfectly solid, perfectly stayed there, which their council could spend £11.5 million on refurbishing and it would be up to scratch. There wasn't an issue with that. That's now been admitted as well. The fact that those residents haven't been able to move out into our council properties, have been denied the right to buy, which they should have done, which quite a few of them would have done, which would have given them a bit more security than what they are at the moment, because it would have been cheaper than the new rents which they would have been able to, which they cannot afford. The very fact that these are the homes which they lived in, they like, they're not a problem with them. I don't have heating problems. In fact, I don't pay for heating at all. It doesn't cost me a penny all year round. Many other residents, you're talking in hundreds per year for their heating. That's how minimal it is. The new build is a lot dearer. The fact that they can actually do their own maintenance, they know these problems, they know these issues, plus the fact that these residents are community members and they know each other and they help each other. They cannot do this when they are scattered, which is what's happening. Even more the fact that a lot of these have disabilities, which they are suffering from, medical issues, which not everybody recognises but people understand, but they're now being asked to move into new properties very, very quickly in the space of 5 days, which includes a weekend, without any adaptations even being talked about. So the problem will be exacerbated and even worse. The fact that these people are already worrying about not being able to pay rent, which they can where they are, the fact that they've got no idea what tax payment is, which they know where they are, the fact that they know that they've got the support which they need, when they move, they haven't got that, they don't know where that is, the fact that part of their medical stuff, which they've had with their doctors, their specialists, because they're moving to another area, do they stay with their GP, do they have to move, where is the new GP, none of this is forthcoming. In fact, the council and the social housing association, which they're supposed to be paying to, has told them absolutely nothing. So each one of these residents will now, who've always been up to date with their rents, will now be falling into arrears. And the fact that on the new tenancy agreement, which they're supposed to be signing, it states there very clearly that if the tenant falls into arrears, they have the right to terminate that tenancy and make that tenant homeless. Then that means that they turn around to the council, and the council turns around and says, well, because you fall into arrears, we don't have to house you, because that's our new policy. So these tenants are stuck. If they stayed where they was, there wouldn't be an issue. You're creating so much of an issue, so much less, so much cost, simply because you move them out of the homes which they are capable of paying for, and are happy to live in and have the support with them into totally different areas which they do not have the support, they cannot afford, and don't know anything about.
That's a good question.
Yeah, it's linked to that about the affordability and the final cost of the council. We've obviously known the history around the Tenant Estate and also the Regeneration Estate. As you know, lots of tenants were moved into the Regeneration Estate on unsecured tenancies. The Barnet Council, do you think the Barnet Council were disingenuous when they were talking to residents of the West End Estate, when they didn't actually make it very, very clear that they wouldn't replace like for like on unsecured tenancies, or that you own my Barnet Council? Do you think that those tenants were sold up?
Well, I'll put it bluntly again. It was made quite clear in the council admitted at the public inquiry number 2 that if the residents didn't accept whatever tenancy was offered to them on the estate, they would be signed up and registered. They had made themselves intended homes. So they had to accept a tenancy, whatever it was. Some of them didn't understand it, some of them did understand it, but they also understood if they did not take a tenancy, they would not have a home. That was made clear at the public inquiry. That's what's so disgusting about the actions which have been taken against the residents. They should have been given secure tenancies.
Yes, thank you very much for coming. I know how much work you've done on behalf of everybody there and continue to do. I'm conscious that this coincides with the Grenfell anniversary. I'm perhaps more emotional in my questioning than I would be because I was quite involved with work there and the community there. I think it's essential that we always remember the people behind the plans and the strategies and the projects, that these are real people and real communities. I wanted to draw attention to a tweet I think you probably saw last night from Brian Coleman, and to ask whether you think that there is possibly a policy of social cleansing, unfortunately, going on in our borough. Thank you.
Right, I will do the first speak of you for the council of Kensington and Chelsea, then I will come on to Brian Coleman. Kensington and Chelsea have had a tenant here on this estate for 7.5 years as a non-secure tenant. The tenant was a victim of domestic violence, was worried, has been had all sorts of abuse from her partner, worried about the 2 children which she has in care, so couldn't speak up. It's been kept here. She then went to the Parliament Council.
Jasmin, can I just make sure that you don't say enough for the tenant to be authentic? Thank you.
Yeah. Didn't get a very good hearing from that of a certain council official, even though she was led to believe otherwise. The fact that she has been moved out very, very quickly and suddenly isolated to another property which has got no security on it at all. That she was actually lied to by Kensington and Chelsea, and I'd like that put on record, please. They deliberately lied to her to get her out of that property into another temporary accommodation for their own means, even though there was happening with Grenville, and they had the disgusting, appalling excuse of saying because of Grenville, they couldn't do a proper job of housing her. Which I think is actually appalling and disgusting for any council to use that for excuse. Going on to Brian Coleman, yes, I saw a tweet, and his statement was that the West End of Regeneration did a great job of social cleansing, which helped the council, the Tories, to win another 3 seats on the borough. That's his statement, and to me, I believe that's a misuse of public funds and should be fully investigated by an independent body, whether it's all free or whether it's down there, so it should be investigated by an independent body completely removed from this council. And I request that that is done, please.
Any other questions? Councillor Brager? Ms. Parsons, it's good to see you again. Just to echo my colleague, Councillor Thompson's word, I think what's done has been done. However, my 2 colleagues and I are planning to do all we can to assist the residents and to ease the transition going forward. And I do urge you to contact us if there
facilities at the community centre. So far, I can see that's not going to happen. I'd like that to continue because that's good for residents, especially ones with mobility problems, which we do have a lot. I'd also like to see an action and strategy plan drawn up by the three councillors and handed over to the partnership board so that we can look at what you're planning, how your plans are, and we can guide you on all the issues which we have. And I can tell you that we have very many issues on that. And I do actually look at our, I don't know if you've noticed about the work which has gone on, the traffic, the late hours working. I would say that there are far more impacts on that. And I do apologise for not covering it sooner. But the fact that the matter is that again, we have been battering along with this for several years, in fact, since it started, the dangerous and unhealthy working practices continues to go on. If the council had been going around and doing their job, i.e. the New Road and Street Works Act, the Traffic Management Act 2004, they have probably coined in at least £750,000 in fines off the Barretts and utility companies, which have been breaking the law and are still breaking the law, and it's £3,000 a pop for every time you do it. That includes the A55s, the Baileys, the BTDs, and so forth. I do understand all this because I do deal with utilities, I do deal with road workings, I do deal with utilities. So I understand it and I know what goes on, and the answers which I've been given back are false. I know it needs to be done and it needs to be tightened up pretty sharpish, or else there are more residents there who have had enough and will be back out on the streets.
Okay, if it's a question, Councillor Drake, have you got a question?
Can I just reply to
briefly, please? We've got two minutes left, okay. And if you... Thank you. Are there any other questions?
When are you going to be putting your action plan to us, please?
Councillor Brody, this is questions for you. Sorry, this is questions to you. Councillor Brody, I urge you as new councillor not to rush into anything and to raise yourself of all the facts from all the parties, from all the sides. And I have no doubt that both of you will be ready to come out of the next week.
You are such a spoiler.
But I'm sure you will be in regular contact. Any other questions?
No. Okay.
I think you've raised a lot of issues.
I think you have.
Yeah. And I think I'm happy to have to follow up in writing as well anything you've submitted to the council. Okay.
So can I do a follow up on this one then?
Yeah. Next meeting, which is 10 minutes.
Well, carry on email correspondence to get this.
Of course, one of our items is the communications updates, and within that, you can see all the different walks and the issues that have been raised there. So, I do know there are other forums, probably more effective forums, to raise these issues. And of course, the local councils need to be aware and involved with those as well. And of course, I have no doubt that they will.
I
understand
that about some of the issues Jasmin raised about you getting into arrears, and I think we need to address that situation. And I don't want, it costs the council money if that happens. It's not, if people are not being paid to the new tenant and how to pay their new rent and move and all that sort of stuff, that is concerning. So, okay.
Can a word be said to the council office buying homes? Because it's very distressing. And we do have a new, we've been writing untold emails back up and forwards to get basic information. All these residents should be getting this basic information well before they're being asked to move anywhere. As you would if you're buying a home or you're moving anywhere, you make all the assessments, physical assessments and financial assessments before you make a decision. These residents are being asked to do it the opposite way around, which is unfair.
Okay, no, officers will take that away. And I'm aware there is a team that tries very hard to contact residents before they need to move and to help them and assist them. Some residents unfortunately are difficult to engage with. There is a team there who try to. We get a lot of anecdotal things this evening. If you've got names and people who genuinely really need help, then of course that can be arranged. We need the names and we need the details. details, but we can take that up on
the If we're there to be fully involved in the process, it makes it a lot easier, but if we're always kept on the outside until there's issues, then obviously that just makes exasperate the whole thing. We should be involved in it all the way through, because the residents trust us. That's the thing. With the history that's gone on, the trust is gone, and it's very, very hard, especially as you've employed another housing officer who had already put in, I put in an official complaint, he'd gone, and now he's back doing the same thing again on the back road, which, you know, is residents have gone, walk off. Don't trust them. Just don't trust. There's no trust here at all with things like that. That's why we have to plough through this stuff and be the liaison between the council and the residents.
Thank you. That brings us to the end of the public session. We now move on to the West End compulsory purchase order. This is the communications update, not the CPOs themselves.